carefully. Last meeting also we have discussed about this command. Yeah, dig google.com space any. So when you type something like that, you are getting an output like this. It means you are trying to get the DNS entries for related to the google.com. Suppose I'm giving for dig for SEIS. We cannot hear you. What is happening today? Are you able to hear my voice?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. But Amruta says that she cannot hear. Amruta, are you able to hear my voice? Amruta? Okay, I think others are able to hear my voice. Shall I proceed with the answer for this one? For the question, how do you get the, yeah, yes, yes. So Jagannath Beg, Sagiruddin, they say yes. Okay, now just look to this command. So I'm giving the command dig space SEIS learn one dot UOHYD dot AC dot in. Okay, this is one domain name. So you know what is it, what does dig trying to do? So dig is basically related to your DNS. Domain name system. What does domain name system do? The domain name system, the foremost and important thing that DNS does is it translates or it converts the domain name into a corresponding IP address. Why? Because in our universe, in the entire internet, we have so many systems, so many electronic devices which are connected to your internet. So every system will have a corresponding IP address. Now we cannot remember so many IP addresses in the entire internet system. That's why we as humans can remember the names. So, but machines do talk with numbers only. Machines do address, machines do communicate, machines do coordinate with the IP addresses only, but not with the domain names. So there is something in between yourself and the machine which is connected on the internet. That something is basically your DNS protocol. The DNS domain name system, that protocol, that system converts your domain name into a corresponding IP address. It means it doesn't convert, there is a procedure, there is a method for that to get the corresponding IP address of a particular domain name. So here, if you see, simply enter dig space SEIS learn one dot UHD dot AC dot in. This is one small example. So what does you get once you enter? See here, you get something here. After I enter the command dig SEIS, what I'm getting is this dig is a 9.11.3 is a version number of the dig tool, which I'm running on the Ubuntu, and I'm looking for querying or getting the replies for SEIS learn one dot UHD dot AC dot in. So what answer, what is that I got? The answer, the answer is yes, I have received an answer here without an error. There is no error in the status. So what does this answer? The question is SEIS learn one dot UHD dot AC dot in is located in IN India and it has got an IP address, and that IP address is basically a capital A. What does capital A denotes? Capital A denotes the IPv4. IPv4. We have only IPv4 addresses to maximum systems in our India. So far in India, most of the organizations, most of the companies, most of the research organizations and industries, they do not went for getting the IPv6. So still we are using IPv4. So here, you see, it says that capital A. Capital A means this particular domain name is mapped, is being network netting has been done with respect to giving an IPv4. See, the IPv4 address 14.139.69.208. This is the IPv4. That's what it is indicating, capital A. If at all you get something like, if I write something like diggoogle.com, what does I'm getting? Diggoogle.com, sorry, dig. Diggoogle.com also I'm getting some IPv4 here. It shows the another IP address which is present on a machine, that particular google.com web server is located there. So you get a different IP address for every dig command you are going to give. So here, when you type the command dig google.com space any means, which implies that any name servers that are associated with. So when you enter here, any which includes other features, not only with the IPv4, you have the name servers also. What is a name server? The name server which belongs to that company, which is you are trying to query. First, initially your request goes to your name server. So NS stands for name server. Now here, along with the capital A, you have another entry called, another record called 4S. This 4S corresponds to IPv6. So you have an IPv6 address for google.com, you have a IPv4 address, that is capital A itself. And what are the name servers? NS1, NS stands for name server. Name server 1, name server 2, name server 3, name server 4. There are four different name servers. So NS1, NS2, NS3, NS4. These are the name servers, we call it as. What is a name server? Means, again, if you go back to my slides, I am just hope, let me just show you this host names, domain names, and DNS resolver. So I am, please understand here, what is a domain name? You can see this is the entire URL is basically your fully qualified domain name or simply uniform resource locator. What are these things indicate? One is a protocol, another is a subdomain, another is your domain. Both subdomain and domain together constitutes a host name. And this is a top level domain, that's country code top level domain, CC. And again, under the country code top level, you have another second level domain, because it corresponds to the type of the organization in which it is being used. So this is the root, which will have simply a dot. Under the root, you have different TLDs, top level domains. Generic top level domains are there, country code top level domains are there, commercial organizations .com you call it as, they are also available. So different types of top level domains are available in our internet field. So here I'm just coming to this slides. So I think you have understood, this is basically in hierarchy, level 1, level 2, like this, there are different levels. So here, if you see what does DNS is trying to do, let us see this example here once again. When you are sitting on this computer, the end user operating system computer, you don't know, this computer does not know the IP address of google.com. So how this machine, the machine in which you are sitting, gets the IP address for that google.com? So in order to get the IP address of google.com, when you are sitting on this machine, what does this machine do? This machine's operating system will send that request. What is the google.com's IP address? The step number one. Step number one shows that it goes to a particular software, that software DNS resolver. So this software DNS resolver is resolving. Resolving means finding out what is the IP address for the request that is coming from the user. So this resolver looks for, if it is having a cache memory is there in this server itself, then from the cache memory, this IP address can be known. Okay, so here, once you get this request from this computer, if this cache is having the corresponding IP address, this DNS resolver gives the response to this requested person. If this server, usually this server is basically present at your internet service provider. Internet means you may have got some internet connection from a service provider like your Vodafone or your Act Fiber or your Hathaway or your Reliance. these service providers, internet service providers, they maintain this DNS resolver software. Sometimes in your organization also you can have this DNS resolver, but nowadays most of the people will have their DNS resolving software. It takes place at the internet service provider. So that DNS resolver, if the IP address of google.com is not present in their cache memory of that resolver, again the request is forwarded. That's step number two. It is forwarded to root name servers. So the root server, this is a root server. There are how many root servers are there? There are 13 root servers. If you might have listened to my video, you will come to know carefully. So again, the root name server, definitely the google.com IP address will not be available on the root name server, because it doesn't maintain all the domains names in this only one server here. The root name server dot, that is the topmost hierarchy in that particular domain name, that is the dot. So again, that request is sent back to this. That's what it is to say, I don't have this google.com's IP address. So, but what I know is, I know where .coms can be there. That's what root NS will tell. Root NS will have only about .com, because this is what the root level, the top level domain level. Once you enter www.google.com, automatically dot is going to be added here. Please remember at the end of this URL. So that dot goes to this root name server. So root name server will don't know the IP address of google.com, but nevertheless it will have the idea about where .com is available. So root name server will tell to this DNS resolver in the step 3, I know where .com is there. So that .com IP address is given to the DNS resolver. Then again, DNS resolver in the step number 4, it will go to where .com IP that was given from the root name server, where is this .com. The .com is a top level domain. That's what TLD, like .com, .in, .mil, .gov, all these are different top level domains. So they all maintains under another name servers called as TLD, top level domain servers. So top level domain servers will have that particular idea where the corresponding lower level domain names are available. So this resolver asks for google.com. google.com IP address is also not present here, but looking into .com, the .coms of what of the Google is known to TLD, then again the response is given to DNS resolver. So DNS resolver again sends a request, what is the IP address of google.com, to Google name server, because this belongs to, the request belongs to Google, the domain. So that request comes to Google name server, and Google name server, that is the names only, the not the exact web servers. So Google name server again sends the response that the web server for google.com is present on so and so machine, that this particular machine, which is not here. So this person will send the IP address to the DNS resolver, and once the DNS resolver gets the IP address of the google.com, that is the Google's, from the Google's web server IP address, then this computer, your computer which you are sitting, will communicate with the web server of the Google. So both of them will talk to each other. Because there are so many computers, so many devices, there are different levels of hierarchies that are being maintained here. So according to this question, the answer for this is, how can we get the name servers? Name server. Name server means NS, NS IP address. If you have entered this command, if you entered this google.com space any, these are all name servers. So you take any one of these name server, NS1, NS2, NS3, NS4, NS means name server, name server of google.com. So you know how to get the IP address of this name server. In my video and the previous class also I have shown you how to get the IP address of a particular domain. So in my video, if you have seen what's my IP, you can go to that, or what's my from you can say that from domain name to IP, domain name to IP. You can go to any of this, host name to IP address or whatever it may be, or you can go to any of what's my IP address, which in the example itself, these are all related to each other. These are all DNS lookup, we call it as. So you can type The names are, you can give the ns1.google.com and get the corresponding IP address. So the IP address of this ns1 is this name server. Name server ns stands for name server of google.com. You get 216.239.32.10. So this answer cannot be the same for everybody, because you are each one of you are connecting to google.com from different IP service providers. They connect to different name servers. So that answer is the answer you need to write it down from your end. If you try it on any of this along with the print screen, if you give it, that will be fine. Now this is one question which has been completed. Similarly, I think there is another question which has come here in the chatting. Okay, this is Arun Dharawat. Did google.com any this command is giving output as connection time dot? Yes, for 3 to 4 students they have asked this question regarding this command is giving output as connection time dot no servers form. See the output, how it gets is, you can see it on my screen. If you are not getting from your side, the reason for this is the output you usually get it like this. The reason for this is your internet service provider may have blocked the response from the name servers of this Google. So you are behind a firewall. It means your internet connection or the internet connection which you have are behind the firewall. When you have the firewall will block certain port numbers. So the port numbers means the service is not going to be provided for you. You cannot know those things. That's what the internet service provider has made a restriction. Because you are behind the firewall, you cannot get the this outputs like this. But I am not behind the firewall, so I can get the answers like this. So that's what I'm trying to show you. If you are not getting the output for this, do not worry about that output. You write down same whatever the error you are getting from. If you are behind the firewall, you write down like this. But you should know that there's something which you can get output like this. So that is the point to. Yes, sir is going to add some information here.
That's okay. That is perfectly all right. At the same time, like say for example, if they want to know the IP address of this ns1.google.com, they don't even have to go to a different place. They can actually dig for ns1.google.com. It will actually give the IP address of that NS server.
Yes, automatically that corresponding IP address will.
IP address it will automatically give.
So here, if you understood the concept very well, there are other alternatives also. That's what the only thing is. You need to get, maybe this is just a beginning, you will get some kind of errors. So people who are having trouble on this dig space google.com space any, this command is giving the output as connection timed out no servers form. The reason for this is you might have behind the firewall. The firewall is abstracting the responses that you are getting here. So that is a configuration usually will be done at the ISP service provider or at your router that you are kept in the home or at your office or wherever you are trying to go. Why there are 4 name servers for google.com? Yes, see, basically Google's if you see, basically the Google maintains different redundant servers. Even if it is one is down, your that request, if you see, if you understood this PPT, this PPT, please understand here carefully, all of you. So only one name server, if this one name server is down, what is that still the Google has to maintain? So usually there will be a backup for those domain servers. For some companies they cannot afford it, they're not able to backup. But Google is a very very big company, so Google definitely maintains different types of numbers, different area wise, the workload balancing the loads on those servers as well as to the areas and geographically they are located. They maintain different name servers, so they'll have the redundancy for that to maintain different numbers, not only 4, sometimes even it can go for 8 also. And if you have seen what are the root servers, if you had simply typed this command, simply one question I have given here already, look onto my screen, those are able to see. If you simply type dig without any parameter, you get, see what are the root servers. The root servers, how many are there here? I think some of you might have already found these answers for this. There are 13 root servers are there. So that is what your root name, these are the root name servers. And these are the top level domain. What are the different top level domains? For you to understand, I have given you .com, our .ac.in, as well as your google.com is there, ac.in I have shown you, but there are other generics. and other types of top level domains are also there, which you will get it from the slides itself. If you go to this our slides, what are the other different things in the same slides? I have given that particular meaning here. These are all .edu, .com, .net, .gov, .mil. These are all the generic TLDs, top level domains, which are originally, when the internet era has come, they have been maintaining these kind of top level domains. BFRD, these are all country codes. This is basically country code top level domains. So under this, you can have different organizations and the corresponding things. So it's the same diagram which I have taken from the textbook. You get more information. Please read it. So the main purpose of the DNS is to translate the names to addresses. So how the translation to name to addresses are taking place is this one particular example. Understand this steps. That will give you the sufficient idea for you. So these things will, some other students, that is the most, could we use the online terminal for this? Yes, we can use it, Somesh, no problem. So that's not a problem. SES does not have any name server. Yes, we do not put any name server. Why? Because the number of requests, the number of users, are how many are there. See, usually name servers are meant for a top level domains. When we, our ac.in, under the ac.in, under the top hierarchy level, under ac.in only we have SCIS learn, which is in the UHYD. So UHYD, we don't maintain UHYD as one top level domain. There the number of users are restricted, number of services are restricted, number of applications are restricted. So when you have many users, many applications, many services are there, you need to provide more infrastructure. So that's what the top level domains will always look into that aspect. That's why we don't have any name servers for our every subdomain. Need not maintain a name server. They take care of that name. So .ac.in, AC itself will take care of that. We are belongs to UHYD. So we are registered under AC only. So that AC will take care of UHYD. So UHYD does not require a special name server. If you have many applications, many users, many services, then we have to go for it. But right now, we are only having certain browsing facility. That is enough for us to have millions of users to use it. So there are thousands of application servers. That's why they go for many name servers. That's what. Many name servers. Why? Because there are so many applications. So many users are there. So many services are there. One second. We can bypass local firewall and direct the query to other name server. Yes, you can bypass your firewall, but no need to you. Sir, name servers are maintained by TLDs. TLDs are different. Name servers are different. Please, again, don't confuse. Yash Rastogi, see here carefully. In this diagram, root name server is at the top. Below the root name server, you have top level domain. That's TLD. Below the top level domain, you have the actual name servers of different companies and different organizations. So you, if you tell you require separate for your Google, because Google, so many people are using, so many services are there, so many applications are there, that's why Google is maintaining one name server. If you don't have this thing, you can maintain it simply at the TLD itself with respect to your under TLD. What is that under TLD is there? Please understand this diagram carefully. There's a lot of meaning here. So TLD is here. Under CCTLD, you have in Indian, India country. Under India, there are again second level domains, .ac, .gov, .mil. So many things will be there. So many companies, .com also can be there here. So something, if your .com is there, that comes under, not under, under in, but it itself is a separate TLD itself, .com. So they have segregated these things. So inside each second level domain, allocate uniquely either third level domains names or host names. See this hierarchy, why there is an hierarchy like this? It is a simple understanding for you. The simple understanding is, see, you are an MCA student. Under MCA, there are 3 years are there, first year, second year, and third year. Again, under third year, in which semester you are there? Again, under which semester, if you have many students are there, there will be many sections will be there. So 60 students in each section. Again, in each section, there will be certain groups of students. So again, in each group, there may be certain category of students. Like this, there is a hierarchy here. So means more name servers means it is optional for millions. Yes, millions of people. If first name server doesn't respond, the other same server will respond to the client. Yes, that is what responses, getting responses is most important. If so one name server is having a heavy load and some problem with the name server, some it is crashed, the other name servers will take care of those service requests, and the service will be on. That is what the providing service. Google, why Google is maintaining 24 hours, 7 days a week, all the time, because it is maintaining that infrastructure is there with them. That is a required. And here one doubt is coming from. Nibas Mandal, I have a question regarding assignment one. Yeah, please tell me what is the question, Nibas. You can either put it on the chat box, or you can send me mail, or you can just ask orally also. No problem. Nibas, can you please? What is your question?
So actually, I was asking for the Google.com space any.
See, that's what Google.com any. For some of you will get the answer, for some of you may not get the answer, but some of you do not get the answer, don't worry about that. At least I have shown you what are the name servers of Google, like this on the now the session I have shown you. So the answers you get it for this is basically like this. When you type it, you can see it here. So you write down the name servers. Now what you get it, I am just once again typing that same command, you get this. So try to find out what is IP address for these name servers. You know how to get the IP address. So everybody should know. What is DNS? What is IP address? What is IPv4? What is IPv6? What is a name server? What is a root server? These are the terms. That's what you need to understand. We are not doing much engineering. We are not going still more depth here. I want you to just get awareness. Firstly, then you can go in very much depth in the later stages. So first understand these protocols very much. So I have shown you the answer here. Try to write down this answer in your book now. And try to find out at least the IP addresses for those. You'll get it from your websites. So I hope everybody might have practiced FTP and SSH. That is the most important thing. Please do practice. Very simple exercise those are. But at least you should know how to retrieve the information from a server, or how do you put a information onto a server. So FTP, SSH, DIG, HTTP, these are the important commands that you need to very much get yourself clarity in the first unit. Practice is very important here, please. Sir, does Gayatri, does type of DNS query mean recursive or iterative? Yes, there are two types actually. I have not mentioned to you on the PPT or these things, since I do not want to go very much depth. DNS query can be either recursive or iterative. Now, if you see the one which I have mentioned to you in this PPT, it is one among them. Can anybody tell me what is it, whether I have done a recursive one or whether I have done an iterative one here? Anyone, please? The one which I have told you, the request first comes from your system to the DNS resolver. If the DNS resolver does not have the IP address of the request that is made by the client, that request is forwarded to root name server. And the root name server will try to give the responses for the domain where that particular IP address can be obtained. So once you get the response from the root name server, the top level domain will be consulted. Again, once it is consulted, again the Google, where is the IP address for the Google name server, will be given from the TLD. Again, that request is being made to the Google name server. Google name server will respond to giving the IP address of the google.com web server. The web server means it is related to web documents. So web documents are maintained on a web server. That is another server. Google name server will maintain all other information such as your Google Suite, Google Web Chats, GTalk, what you are seeing, the Google Meets, and all they are maintaining on this name server will maintain all those respective web servers there. So then the Google name server will give the IP address of Google web server, and that IP address is known to your client. Then the client will talk to Google web server, and exchange of information takes place between these two. So these all things will happen very fastly, very in milliseconds, very fastly. You may not see that effect, but in the background, all these things gets exchanged between your request and all these things. So So once you got the IP address of Google Web Server, that IP address is going to be stored on the cache memory. The cache memory means this server, this computer, this server will have a cache memory, a small memory, because a frequent request comes. So whenever again you are sitting on this, whenever you type google.com, the same procedure is not repeated, because that google.com web server's IP address is known automatically. This the DNS is already give back the response to the client to get the contact to your Google's web server for communicating easily. So that's what these people will do. So here, sending the request and getting the responses, there are two ways here. Either you recursively do it, what do you mean by recursive here? Or you can do it iteratively. Iteration means one after the other. So can anybody answer? Yes, it is recursive. Yes, whatever I have shown you is basically a recursive one. You are going to repeat that particular process because your DNS resolver keeps on repeating the same thing. It is asking for this. Your DNS resolver is keep on asking where is the IP address, where is the IP address for so many people, from root to TLD, TLD to the Google name server, and so on and so forth. Of course, because of the time constraints, you need not worry about the complete technical details here. At least everybody should know the basic concept and the basic philosophy, what exactly is happening in the background. So that's what my intention to make you to understand here. Yeah. So Gayatri, that is basically your recursive. Yeah. Any other questions, please? So the next unit, that HTTP, please do practice the second week's HTTP, the curl command. Everybody should do the curl practice, assignment 2. Monday onwards, we'll give the unit 2. That is our client-side scripting. We start with HTML. So HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, you are starting from Monday onwards. Means those presentations will be made available to you on the Moodle. So you need to start learning from this Monday onwards for the client-side technologies. Regarding to one of the students' doubt is on that entire architecture. That term is not seen on the textbook, so it was difficult to find out. That's what some of you have. Last meeting also, I think Subramanian, somebody else has mentioned. And other student also send a request message to me stating that it is let me pinpoint the topics which I'm discussing from the textbook. See, yeah, if you have seen this one, that entire architecture, maybe I thought I had given that information during my video presentation. Maybe during the video it might have cut or it might have missed somewhere. If you are not getting the entire means number of levels. So again, I'm explaining to you all those are present in today's and those who may see the recording later. So this two-tier, what do you mean by two-tier? The examples what you are seeing is basically is a two-tier, the client server model. So what you are seeing is in this diagram, client is on at one side, server is on the other side. So this is basically two-tier. Two tiers means two different levels. One is at the client side, another is at the server side. Both of them are talking to each other, client and the server. That's why two-tier. But if you see in this, the server side, there is something in this diagram, there is a CPU box and there is something spherical shape, small image is there here. This is basically, this denotes a storage. Generally, you see in our IT field, this particular symbol denotes storage. So this is a database server is going to be also present in this along with the web server. So whenever you have some server, usually the server means web server, database server. These are the two most common things. A web server serves the web documents. Database server serves the database request. Database, you know, where your data is being organized and data is being stored in an organized manner. So if database server and web server are on the same machine, then we simply call it also, generically we call it as a server. So server is at one end and the client is at other end. So that's why there are only two ends here, two different levels, two different endpoints. That's why you say two-tier. If suppose this database server is not present with along with the web server, it is present separately at some other point. So database server is at one end, web server is at another end, and the client is at another end. So there are three levels here. So when you have three levels, basically our networking and communication terminology, we call it as three tiers. Or it can be some request objects, something like that. If there are three different people who are serving some request and doing some kind of data exchange or communication with the help of three different levels, with the help of three different entities. We call it as three tier. And what is n tier? Small n indicates number of levels, number of tiers. It can be not, need not be three, it can be four, it can be five, it can be six, it can be seven, eight, nine. If you are, Google is maintaining n number of levels there. So basically that becomes an entire. You can have so many requests, so many services can be done there. Just this is an idea for you. So this textbook, what you are seeing the first unit, basically the our these 2 weeks, this textbook is basically covers your, the one which you are talking here, the textbook what we are referring to here. So this textbook what we are seeing basically, okay, just let me show you the slide, the one which you are referring, the this particular textbook, Computer Networking Principles, Protocols and Practice, on the application layer protocol chapter. That chapter discusses two different types of networks. One is client server network, another is peer to peer networks or peer models. So client server, basically client server is one person is asked something and the server tries to respond to that request. So that request and responses can be at a different levels. That's why you call it as entire. So that meaning that author has given only in one two lines, only in one paragraph. So that is this present in this particular textbook. So you have, I don't want you to very much stressful in trying to find out those answers there. So, but nevertheless, it will be an idea for you. At least you should know, at least because that is asked in the quiz, at least you will now know what is meant by at least entire or two tier or three tier. What does it mean? So that point which I thought it has come in my video, maybe during the editing it might have cut down, but maybe nevertheless you'll get it. So if you don't have client server, if you don't have the client server, means client server networking is, that particular philosophy is not there, networking philosophy is not there, client server, then what you have is something called as peer to peer. So in peer to peer, nobody is called as client, nobody is called as a server, everybody is a client and server both. That particular point I mentioned in my video also actually. So in peer to peer, what happens is everyone has got equal rights. That's why they are called peers. So nobody is asking and nobody is giving. Anybody can ask, anybody can give, something like that. Everybody has equal rights. So in the client server, client is can only ask, and in the server, server can only provide the services for the requests that are coming from the clients. So in peer to peer, everybody is like a client as well as like a server. But in client server, there are designated clients. There are something systems which are very much designated. Where if you are sitting on the laptop, your laptop is a client. You yourself is a client, because you are not having any information to be serviced. If somebody asks you to give some documents, are you able to give some documents? What are the documents that person is able to ask? No, because we are just asking persons. Those we are called as clients. So if anybody is having those documents, they can serve the documents, they can give the documents to us. That's why they are called servicing people, the servers. So they have the information with them, they will serve for us. So in our networks, we have two important things. One is client server, another is peer-to-peer. Apart from these two, if you look to the latest technologies, there is something also called cloud networking. There is a cloud concept is also there. And there is something called as terminal networking also, where there is no client server, but a terminal is going to ask and the terminal is going to get some requests from the servers, or host networking. So there are different terms used by different authors and different people in the IT field. So you should not confuse with all those jargons. Technically speaking, what is meant by client, what is meant by server? You try to understand these two words. Very, looks very simple, but they got lot of information are there. So you need to understand what is client and what is server. So if you can understand what is peer also, that is enough for you, and you'll study more in your networking other courses. But at this particular web technologies, internet technologies point of view, please understand what is client server. Is a client is a person who is going to ask a request. So from your browser, you are entering the URL. It means you are trying to ask about, to know about what is uh4e.ac.in. and you get the service, corresponding service from the uhod.ac.in, where the documents are available. You get the responses from those servers. That's why it is called client server model. So in peer-to-peer, if you see in peer-to-peer what happened, if you see the diagrams in peer-to-peer, distributed hash table technique is also one of the peer-to-peer technique only. So what happens in peer-to-peer? In the peer-to-peer, every node, every computer is the same. There is no client and there is no server. So most of you might have seen BitTorrent protocol. The BitTorrent protocol follows this peer-to-peer networking only. So everybody can store the data, everybody can share the data. If they have the data, they can share it. So like this, this entire overlay networks are going to be established on this peer-to-peer networkings. Peer-to-peer means same properties, same principles, same values are present for each one of us. Those are getting connected with each other. In client server, one is called client. Definitely the other person is, another person is designated as server who can serve the things. So there is a difference between peer-to-peer and client server. That you please understand that difference here basically. Any other doubts, please? Different computer connected together is peer-to-peer network. Yes, if you simply make each computer to connect, you can call it as a work group computer. You can call it as a peer computers. Yes. If you make one among that connected computer, if you make one computer as a server, then that network now is called as client server. Otherwise, if you only you connect simply the computers without any server softwares, they are simply peer-to-peer softwares only, peer-to-peer networks. Now, any other doubts, please? Yes, Sagirudhan, yes, if only computers are getting connected with each other, they are called peer-to-peer network. This chat room is peer-to-peer, yes, exactly. Yes, everybody is able to send data, very good. Everybody able to receive the data and you can host it. We are all the same peers. The same, that's why all participants are same here. That's why you call it as peer-to-peer. Yeah, any other doubts, please? Very good. I will see a good response from our team. Means our we are all together sailing on the same boat. So what is the Google here? Google is serving for us. Google server is at a different location. Google server is at present in a different location. That fellow becomes a server for us. We are all clients here. If everybody is start talking to Google, then it becomes a client server. I could see, Oh, what is BNS? Backus Noor form. It is a style of writing grammar. It is basically a BNS stands for a grammar. Grammar means set of rules. Are you able to see me and are you able to hear me? Suddenly the chat window has gone. Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. Audible.
Yeah, suddenly something has gone wrong here. I don't know. Okay. Yeah. Yes, yes. So BNS stands for basically the way you write a statement. What is the rule that you need to follow? See, if you, this is one example, just one example, let me tell you this, because you can understand, if you understand the example, you can, you lost your network connection trying to reconnect. Am I audible to you? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, because I'm getting the statement, you lost your network. Okay. So quickly, just see here carefully. If you see anything that you want to talk with some other system, I because you are in the client server, you want to talk to somebody. If you know the English and that fellow, the person who is also going to know the English, then only you'll be able to talk to with each other because both of you can understand with each other. Yes. So there is some kind of communication, understanding between each other. Then only the two people can talk and understand with each other. If I'm talking in Chinese and the other person does not know the Chinese, there's no point in having communication. So communication has to have certain protocol, certain rules. So then only each one of us can easily send the data and receive the data. Both of them can communicate with each other. So to have a proper rules, that's what in the olden days, the people have framed up certain protocols. That's called as rules. So those protocols should have certain syntax. Syntax means the way you write it. Suppose if you write the IP address 10.1.0.0, it is a 4-byte address. Why only 4-byte? That is the rule they have made. So those 4 bytes has got certain nomenclature. What does the first 3 bytes do? What does the last byte do? Where is the network ID? Where is the host ID? It means some rule they have made it for the IP address. So this Backus Nur form, similarly, if you see our URL, what is this URL? If I look to you, this URL, the domain names, what is this? The URL has got certain rule here. What is it? URL? URL says that first you start with a protocol, then followed by special characters, colon, forward slash, followed by your subdomain name, followed by your domain name, and followed by dot, followed by the second level TLD, followed by the top level domain. So there is a structure here. That structure is nothing but the rule, is nothing but the grammar. You have to define that rules are nothing but they are called as grammars. So Backus Nur form, that is the olden way of writing. Backus, those people, they have given certain conditions, they have written certain style to write a particular statement in a particular form. That's why you call it as a Backus Nur form grammar. Sir, what's hello and hello? See, when you interchange the characters, that's what sir was asking to you for the encoding purpose. So the encoding, that's what your web page contains, the encoding of characters. That Backus Nur form is also basically your set of characters that are need to be properly encoded and properly framed out so that two people can talk with each other, two computers can talk with each other comfortably. If there is no proper understanding, there is nothing. So that is just the encoding process, Gayatri, basically hello and hello. Okay, I think sir has left. So anyway, any other questions you have? So we'll continue our discussions on the coming Monday session. So all the best, take care. Why there are only 13? 13 number, you have seen that answer, that A dot root dot DNS, A dot D, A, B, C, D. Yeah, sir, there is an extension in the web that makes automatic admit into the Google Meet. I think it will be useful if you can use it. Yes, but see, the problem here is we don't know sometimes, maybe outsiders, other people are also going to join here. Unnecessarily, we don't want to make any complex things in the later stage. That's why we know our students very well, so we know where our participants can be there. If other people join, then unnecessarily make some disturbances for us. That's why we are not given that access to all of them, so that it is our group. Anyway, it is recording is maintained. Those are absent, they can do that recording similarly. Yeah, let us see. That's what Subramani. Yeah. Anyway, let us continue this in our Monday's meeting. So, yeah, take care.